Brothers and sisters, if you would please rise and remain standing while the family is seated. Thank you. Please be seated. Brothers and sisters, we gather today as family and friends, those who have been so blessed to know Karen Peery, to honor her life, to celebrate her and worship our Heavenly Father and our Savior Jesus Christ. My name is Bishop Winder, and I am humbled to be conducting this service today. We recognize President Adam Sof, first counselor in the Rose Canyon Stake Presidency, who's seated on the stand with me today, and he is presiding at this service. We'd like to thank Robin Allen for that beautiful and comforting prelude music, and for accompanying us today during this service. We're also grateful to Sister Judy Riley, who'll be leading the songs today in our service. We'll begin now by singing Love is Spoken Here. You'll find an insert in your program with the words of this song. Following the opening song, the invocation will be offered by Karen's granddaughter, Sydney Nelson.
Thank you. Our dear most kind and gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you that we're able to be here together as family and friends of Karen DeLila Peery, and we ask at this time that we'll be able to have comfort during this celebration of such a wonderful woman's life, and we ask that we'll be able to feel hers and his love today as we listen to everyone's talks about her and say goodbye for a time to our dear loved one. We ask for a particular comfort on Grandpa or Kirk Peery, that he might not feel alone and will know that we are with him and that she is with him. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.
Thank you, Sydney, for that beautiful prayer. Brothers and sisters, our program today will go as follows. We'll first hear a life sketch from Kristen Casto. She will be followed by Karen's daughter, Karalee Nilsson, will speak to us. We'll then be privileged to hear a musical number, two musical numbers together, Going Home and The Greatest Among Us. And that will be sung by Roger and Dugan Brunker with Julie Brunker on the flute and accompanied by Diane Lee. Following the musical number, we'll hear from Karen's son, Kase Peery, and we'll go to that point in the program.
Okay. On a beautiful spring day in the middle of May, my sweet mother entered this world. She was raised in a tight-knit and loving home with her two younger siblings, Laurie and Roger. Throughout her life, my mother and her family would get together as often as possible. You name it, they would get together for it. They simply loved spending time together. I have always felt very blessed that my mother grew up in a home that centered around family and loved to create family traditions. My mom graduated from Ogden High School in 1965 and attended Weber State College to study English. On Thanksgiving night in 1968, my mom met my dad at a church dance. He often told me that she was the prettiest girl in the room. She had a radiance about her, and her dance card was so full it took him all night just to get one dance. Obviously, it worked out for him. The real adventure started when they welcomed their three fabulous children into the world. Oh, wait a minute. They married on May 3rd, 1969, and were later sealed for time and all eternity in the Jordan River Temple. The real adventure started when they welcomed their three fabulous children into the world. They first had me, then my brother Kase, and then last but definitely not least, my sister Karalee. Once Karalee started kindergarten, my mom worked for many years with the hustle and bustle of radio. One of my favorite memories during those years were the free concert and backstage passage she'd get for me and my friends. Well, I was a teenager after all. Wanting to find a better environment, she changed her career and went to work as the executive secretary for the president of Deseret Book. Not only did she find a job she loved, but it was here that her testimony deepened and she truly became converted to the gospel of Jesus Christ. She retired after 15 years. She now had the opportunity to spend more one-on-one time with her parents, her siblings, her husband, and develop a stronger relationship with her children and her grandchildren. One of her more cherished memories during this time was her and her siblings getting together every Friday afternoon to spend time with her parents in Ogden. She often remarked that retiring was the best decision she made. It was one of the more cherished time in her life. My mom was an active volunteer in the community throughout her life. She worked many years as a voter registration volunteer. She served on multiple committees for the Jordan Education Foundation. She taught diabetes classes. She even helped form a group called the Queens of Clean that taught cleaning and organizational skills throughout the community. My mom was a real go-doer. She always wanted to get involved and make a difference. She was a great example to me in this regard, and I really admired that about her personality. Of course, my mom was also known for her stylish and her spunky appearance. She was a hip grandma, and the grandkids would say, often say she had, quote, a rockin' grandma hair. She wrote witty and clever rhymes, created marvelous family traditions, was a friend to all, and last but certainly not least, she was a notorious clean freak. And and a world-class organizer. Her favorite items were her feather duster, which she loved to torment me when I stayed out too late by coming into my room humming every morning before dawn and then tickling my nose as she dusted my room. Her bottle of Thorough, the solution to everything, her label machine, and her trusty Sharpies. She was a bit of an overachiever when it came to labeling and cataloging literally everything. While it was once a joke that my family would, well, we once joked about it, it's now a treasured memory that means the world to me. My mom was a devoted member of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints and had a deep love for her Savior. She held various callings in the Relief Society, Young Women, and Primary. She particularly loved working with the young women. Her final and cherished calling was serving as a primary chorister. One of her last requests in her final weeks of her life was to have the primary children come and sing to her. It was one of the most memorable experiences for her and my dad, and brought her such joy. And I think the primary and all that they did to make her last few days of her life so important and memorable for her. My mom and dad served as ordinance workers in the Jordan River and Ochre Mountain temples. They also served three senior couple missions. They particularly loved their time spent with the people in the Tongan Pioneer Ward. My mom manifested Christ-like love in her everyday interactions. She had a remarkable gift for making everyone around her feel loved, cherished, and accepted. When you were in my mom's presence, she made you feel that you were the most important person in the world. My mom was deeply committed to her family. She said it perfectly herself. I want my children and grandchildren to know that family is everything. If you are going to invest your time in anything, invest it in family. Everything else turns to dust, but family is forever. As I reflect on these last few weeks of my mom's life, the things that I have felt the most powerfully and the things that have been impressed upon my heart is gratitude. I am so grateful. I have so much gratitude in my soul. I don't have adequate words to express what I'm feeling in my heart. I am so thankful that I chose gratitude. It is a choice. When we open ourselves to the Lord, when we create an environment where the Spirit can reside, and when we choose gratitude, the Lord expands our capacity to feel joy. He increases our ability to see all of our blessings, to see His tender mercies. It unlocks the door to heaven, and it helps us more powerfully feel God's love. I'm so grateful to my Savior, to my Father in heaven, for the time that I had with my mom. I'm
I'm grateful for the environment she created the last few weeks of her life. The spirit was so strong, and it helped heal my heart and my soul. It helped deepen my testimony of the Savior and my Heavenly Father and the gospel. I'm so grateful. I'm so grateful for the plan of salvation and knowing that I will see my mom again. And I say these things in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Good morning. It's good to see all of you here. I just want to take a minute before I write some of the words that I prepared, which will be a little fumbled because they were late last night because I really couldn't bring myself to sit down and write this. But I just want to say, we kind of live in a world that we hear a lot of negative and we focus on the bad. But can I just tell you, the outpouring of love that we have received from people, the prayers and just wishes of comfort and flowers and everything, I'm just here to say don't believe it. Don't believe it. There's a lot of good in the world today, and you are a part of that good. And so I just wanted to take a minute to say thank you. Thank you for being here, for being good, and for making a time in my life that's been hard a little easier because of your faith, because of your prayers, because of your support. So I just wanted to say that before I fumble my way through the next little bit. Mr. Rogers was often known to state the following, quote, "All of us have had special ones who have loved us into being. Think of those who have helped you become who you are, those who have cared for you and wanted what was best for you in your life," end quote. He would then ask people to take 1 minute of silence to think about those who were who those special people were in their life. My mother was that special person in my life. She was my cheerleader, my confidant, and my friend. However, her positive influence on my life was more than just that of a loving and supportive mother. Her example has had a great impact on my life, shaping me into the person I have become and the person that I hope to still be able to become and strive to become. I would like to share just a few of the things, her examples that were that made the greatest impact on my life. Number one, my mother chooses to focus on the good in others. I saw this attribute in her time and time again in her own personal relationships, looking past others' faults or shortcomings to see their strengths. Likewise, time and time again in our conversations together, she would encourage me to do the same. This was particularly true if I was complaining or voicing my concerns about those she knew and loved. The second thing is, she was a wonderful listener and a devoted friend. My mother taught me that people don't want your advice as much as they just want someone to sincerely listen to them, to be heard. She knew the importance of relationships and was always willing to listen. Now, this is not to say that she didn't have a strong opinion and viewpoints, because she did, and freely expressed them often. But when it came to her personal interactions and her relationships with others, she was a listener first. And as a natural know-it-all and an opinionated person on everything myself, it has taken me years of watching her to begin to understand that one of the best things that I can do to help another person is to listen, saying nothing until asked. I have a long way to go to be like her in this area. Third, okay, she went about doing good. You have heard from my sister about how my mother's service in church and community, but those are all true. But where I saw this attribute the most was with her own family, particularly once she had grandchildren. From babysitting to dog watching, from Christmas traditions, treat lists, and of course, Leatherby's, she put time and effort into creating a family atmosphere of love, laughter, and belonging. Again, I hope and pray that I can follow her example in this. Now, these are my own personal experiences with my mother. But now to take a page from Mr. Rogers' book, so to speak, I would like to ask you to take a minute of silence and invite you to think about her example in your life and how she loved and cared for you. Now, if you are here as someone who is just supporting us and didn't know her very well, I ask you to take this time to think about any of the special people in your life who have helped you become who you are, those who have cared for you and wanted what was best for you in your life. So, I don't have my watch, so I'm really going to give just a minute of silence that you can think about her and your own experiences. We don't take time to do that very often, do we? I agree. In a funeral address for Elder L. Tom Peery in June of 2015, President Dallin H. Oaks taught that a funeral is a time to speak of things of eternity. He then testified, quote, that because of the atonement and the resurrection of Jesus Christ, death is merely a necessary step in our destined transition from mortality to immortality. We know that the resurrection is sure, and we testify it is a reality for all who have ever lived. It is central to what the prophets have called the great and eternal plan of deliverance from death, parts of the plan of redemption which was laid from the foundation of the world. Resurrection. What a beautiful word. What a glorious reality. End quote. I would just like to take this time to share my personal testimony. Being with her when she passed, there was a beautiful feeling of calm and joy. It was true rest. And again, this past Wednesday, I had the opportunity to be in the temple with my father. And again, her presence was felt so strongly. I leave you my personal witness that she continues on, retaining all her good attributes and habits of going about doing good, seeing the good in others, being a devoted listener and friend, and above all, taking time to watch over and care for her family. Brigham Young said about those who die, quote, "We have more friends behind the veil than on this side, and they will hail us more joyfully than you were ever welcomed by your parents and your friends in this world, and you will rejoice more when you meet them than you ever rejoiced to see a friend in this life, and then we shall go on from rejoicing to rejoicing, and from one intelligence and power to another, our happiness becoming more and more exquisite and sensible as we proceed in the words and powers of life. End quote. I leave you with my personal testimony that I know that we have a Heavenly Father who lives and that He loves us. In a talk President Thomas S. Monson gave called We Never Walk Alone, he closed his remarks with these words, quote, "Your Heavenly Father loves you, each of you. That love never changes. It is not influenced by your appearance, by your possessions, or by the amount of money you have in your bank account. It is not changed by your talents and abilities. It is simply there. It is there for you when you are sad or happy, discouraged or hopeful. God's love is there for you, whether or not you feel it or feel that you deserve His love. It is simply always there." End quote. Because Heavenly Father loved us, He sent His Son, Jesus Christ. And I know that I will see my mother again. And it all is all made possible through our Savior, Jesus Christ. About a week before my mom's passing, I wasn't sleeping. And I woke up about 3 o'clock in the morning with this song in my head. Well, the first that came into my mind, actually. The thing that was said to Mary when she was at the tomb. "Why seek ye the living among the dead? He is not here, He is risen." And in that moment, I knew that my mom, because of Him, would rise again and that she lives on. This is the song that came into my head. This is the first verse. "We'll sing all hail to Jesus' name and praise and honor give to Him who bled on Calvary's hill and died that we might live." I am grateful for this understanding. I am grateful to have had such a sweet mother. I guess I'm grateful to have a sweet mother. I just caught myself using her in the past tense. I promised I would never do that. And I'm grateful to my Savior, Jesus Christ, for making that possible. There's a scripture in Alma that captures exactly how I feel right now, and I'm going to end with that. It's Alma 26:16. It says, "Therefore, let us glory. Yea, we will glory in the Lord. Yea, we will rejoice, for our joy is full. Yea, we will praise our God forever. Behold, who can glory too much in the Lord? Yea, who can say too much of His great power and of His mercy, and of His long-suffering toward the children of men? Behold, I say unto you, I cannot say the smallest part of which I feel." And I leave that with you in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Just going home, quiet like some still day. I'm just going home. It's not far, just close by, through an open door. beaten tomb. Lots of folk gathered there, all the friends I knew. Morning star lights the way, restless dream all done. Shadows gone, break of day, real life just begun. There's no break, there's no end, just a just going home. It's not far, just close by, through an open door. Servant, this king among men, to lift and to heal by the power in his hand. He labored unceasingly, knowing our need, and he calls us to follow in spirit indeed. The greatest among us taught us to love, to serve one another as he willingly served. And if I would follow him, such is my call, for the greatest among us was the servant of all. The greatest among us nourished the weak, brought hope to the hopeless, and joy to the meek. The sufferer never besieged him in vain. May I follow the Master in kindness unfeigned. The greatest among us taught us to love, to serve one another as he willingly served. And if I would follow him, such is my call, for the greatest among us was the servant of thank you. another as he willing served. And if I would follow him, such is my call. For the greatest among us was the servant of all. For the greatest among us was the servant of all. I'm just going
Before I share any of my comments, I want to just take a moment and have everyone pause to what they are feeling more than what they have heard. What a beautiful spirit is here. Even the spirit of our Lord Jesus Christ delivered through the Holy Ghost. If I'd have known how that song would have gone, I would have put that first in the program. Did you know that, Bishop? It was beautiful. Roger, Dugan, Julie, Diane, thank you for sharing your gifts with us. And to my sisters, Kristen and Karalee, thank you for your words. Well, this is my family and friends. This is a joyous occasion, not a time for sorrow, but a time for joy. I'll build upon that a little bit later. About 3.5 weeks prior to Mom graduating, getting her degree in mortality first before us, I had I'll call it a sacred mother and son experience. I had about 3.5 hours of just Mom and son time. And during that time, I felt impressed to ask my mom for something that I didn't think I would receive. But true to the Savior's words, ask and ye shall receive. I know that to be true. I asked my mom if she'd be willing to do a video for my son Brendan, her grandson. That would be the only family member that wouldn't be present to say goodbye or be here at her funeral, as he is serving the Lord Jesus Christ in the Fortaleza East Brazil mission. And so he's the only one that's not here, and I asked if she would do a video for him, and surprisingly she said, sure, be happy to. Well, when Mom wants to be videoed, which is never, or photographed, which is really never, I pulled out the phone and started recording. Well, what turned out to be, I thought, what a few moments, turned out to be 19 minutes of wonderful memory and powerful testimony, bearing her witness and testimony to her grandson. But it wasn't more than about 24 hours before I realized, truthfully, that the Spirit was saying, That message needs to be shared. Not from you, but from her. And so, with a lot of trepidation at first, I'm like, well, when I was growing up, there was a saying that Kase did it. Those in my family know that that was probably true. Okay, it was true. I may be in trouble when I get on the other side of the veil. I'm taking full accountability and responsibility now. That I have taken through my weak editing skills 7 minutes and 2 seconds of mom's testimony. And I pray, as I said before, that we will not pay attention to what we hear, but more of what we will feel. Now, I'm not the best with technology, so we will see. And I want to thank Bishop Winder and President Sof, I apologize, for allowing this to happen. And as my mom would say, you're going to hear it from the horse's mouth.
I want to bear you my testimony. And my testimony has changed. How could it not have? I think the best of what we have to offer comes through the furnace of affliction. And for whatever reason, that seems to be the Lord's way. He puts us through the furnace of affliction, and somehow we just come out better and stronger for it. My family is everything to me, and I want you to know that. Our family is everything. And I think that that's another thing that I would want you to know. In the end, Brendan, family's everything. In the end, there's nothing left. When you get to be my age, and in this situation that I'm in now, you come to realize that in the end, there's nothing left but family. And I guess that's why family is everything, because that's what's left. Life is a gift. Life is truly a gift. And I think that's something else that I would say to you. Brendan, live life to the fullest, because it is a gift. And only when you realize that it's being cut short do you realize what a true treasure and gift it is. So live life to the fullest, definitely, okay? I know how much our Father in Heaven loves us and how much He cares about us, how intimately He is involved in our lives. He gave us the Savior. In one sense, that says it all, doesn't it? That He was able to... He gave us the Savior. And then, of course, there's the Savior and how much He loves us and how much He cares about us and how much He was willing to sacrifice for us. Oh, my goodness. In fact, I honestly can't even... I can't completely comprehend. I'm just being honest. I can't completely and truly comprehend exactly what He sacrificed for us, what that must have been like for Him. I can't even comprehend it. And I'm ever grateful, forever grateful to Him for what He was willing to do for us. I know that our Father in Heaven and the Savior love you. And I know that they love you more than you can even imagine. I know that there's life after death. What a glorious thing to know. What a blessing and a glorious thing to know that life goes on. And that we'll be reunited with people that we have loved dearly here. And that we will be waiting for people that we leave here that will someday join us. And what a grand reunion that also will be. And I don't believe these things, Brandon. I don't believe them. I know them. They're just part of the fabric of my being, I guess, now. I just know that they're true. I just know it's true. And I'm so grateful. I'm just so grateful for that knowledge. And I want you to know also just how much our Father in Heaven and the Savior have been with me during this time. I'm not even going to say it's been really, really difficult, because there have been some difficult moments, yes. And I'm sure there will be some difficult moments ahead. But overall, by and large, it hasn't been that difficult. It really hasn't. And maybe it's because they're with me that it's not difficult. But I just want you to know that they have been ever with me. And I know that. What a blessing, Brandon, it is to have the priesthood. Oh my goodness. I'm gonna get emotional again. I can't imagine having to go through what I've gone through. And like I said, in some ways it hasn't been all that bad, but when the times have been tough, I cannot imagine what it would have been like to not have the priesthood power in my home and in my family. And one of the things I am eternally grateful for, and I want you to know this too, is that all of my grandsons hold the priesthood. Kase holds the priesthood. Your dad holds the priesthood. Jason holds the priesthood. Anthony holds the priesthood. My brother Roger holds the priesthood. And each of my grandsons hold the priesthood. Do you have any idea what a blessing that is? I can't even hardly express what a blessing that is. To know that the priesthood is in your home and in your family. Husbands and fathers and sons and grandsons worthy to hold that priesthood and to give blessings. There is, in fact, there is no greater blessing, at least not to me right now. There is no greater blessing. Just wanting you to know how much I love you, how proud of you I am. And that frankly, in the eternal scheme of things, it won't be long before I see you too. I love you, Brandon. Goodbye for now.
Exactly. Again, what have you felt more than heard? It's beautiful, isn't it? When Mom mentioned the word Brandon, I should have put a disclaimer before I showed that when you hear the word Brandon, you should substitute your name instead, in its place. Because Mom will tell you that exactly. She would say the same thing to you that she would say to anyone. Kristen Kristen mentioned the culture and environment Mom created. We grew up in a beautiful, wonderful home. Because Mom, as you saw, is a true disciple of Jesus Christ. She was faithful to her covenants and remained so. If I were to compare any verse of scripture to Mom, it is Galatians chapter 5, verses 22 and 23, where it says, "But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance." Is that not Mom? It is. She taught us all that, to be that, to live that. And those spirits and that quality and those attributes are what's present today, right here, right now. And that's definitely the Spirit of the Lord testifying to each of you that what you have heard is absolutely true. The Savior taught in John chapter 14, verse 27, "Peace I leave with you. My peace I give unto you. Not as the world giveth, give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither be afraid." And that's how I look at this service. That's why I started off by saying this is joyful. There is no room for sorrow, but joy. Lastly, when I asked Mom what she wanted me to say at her service, she was very, very quick to say, "You make sure you testify how much I knew Heavenly Father and Jesus lives." And I went, "Perfect, you're going to say that." This was a few days after I already made the determination that she was going to be a keynote speaker at her own funeral. But then she said, "You make sure you testify of the Savior's divinity and reality and how he's been with me. Everyone, my family, my friends, my associates must know that." And I would like to finish by quoting the Savior's words. And see how this applies unto you, because I know they apply unto every one of us. He said in 3 Nephi chapter 9, starting in verse 14, "Yea, verily I say unto you, if ye will come unto me, ye shall have eternal life. Behold, my arm of mercy is extended towards you, and whosoever will come, him or her will I receive. And blessed are those who come unto me. Behold, I am Jesus Christ, the Son of God. And as many as have received me, and as many as have received me, to them have I given power to become the sons or the daughters of God. And even so will I to as many as shall believe on my name. For behold, by me redemption cometh." My family, my friends, I know the Savior's words are true. I rarely use the word absolute. It never fits. Rarely in anything. But when we talk of Christ, when we preach of Christ, when we rejoice in Christ, His words are absolute. They will be fulfilled. I know that to be true. I am grateful for a loving Heavenly Father who gave me a beautiful and loving mother to mentor, to correct, to guide, as Kristen pointed out, and to dust our nose at 4:30 in the morning. I've missed that. But as Mom will say, right here, right now, because I know she is here, she would say, "Don't you dare fuss over me. Why are you sad? You should be joyous, happy, and glad." Now, I did sound like her, didn't I? Oh, she rhymes all the time. Well, the gospel of Jesus Christ is true. I thank God, our Heavenly Father, for that absolute truth. May we all receive Christ and partake of His goodness. Now, I will close by saying this. I know, you have each felt the Spirit. More importantly than what you have heard today from this pulpit, or will yet hear, what has the Spirit told you to do? What corrections do we need to make in our lives? And I am the first in line. What corrections do we need to make in our lives to receive Him? As He said, His arms are open, ready to receive. May we all accept His perfect and open invitation. And this I pray and say in the sacred name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Wow, brothers and sisters, what a beautiful service we've had. The messages and the music have been so touching, and the Spirit of our Lord has been here. Before I share some very brief remarks, I wanted to announce the rest of the program. Following my remarks, we'll sing closing hymn number 136, "I Know That My Redeemer Lives." Following the hymn, Brother Jason Casto will offer the closing prayer. Now, following the closing prayer, the time will then be turned over to the Larkin Mortuary to direct the pallbearers in loading Karen's casket and leading the family procession to the graveside service, which will be held at the Spanish Fork Cemetery. The address is found on the program. Once all the members of the family have arrived there at the cemetery, Sister Peery's grave will be dedicated by her husband, Kirk Peery. We recognize those that have been designated as pallbearers. I'll read their names. Jaden Casto, Joshua Casto, Jared Casto, Ethan Peery, Brendan Peery, Keaton Peery, Alex Nelson, Trevor Nelson, and Robbie Pardo. On behalf of the Peery family, we express our love and gratitude for all of you who have supported them through this time. and continue to support them. We thank all those who have prepared this service and the work that has gone into making this such a special occasion. Now, I'd just like to share a few words. I've had the blessing of knowing Karen and Kirk for just a short time as they have lived here in our ward and lived with the Castos. But what an impact they have made on me. I love something that's already been mentioned, but I want to touch on it again, and that is the way in which Sister Peery prepared the environment around her in her home these last weeks. The Spirit of the Lord was so palpable. I see it as a parting gift that she created with the help of the Lord to leave her family, to be touched in such a way that they'll never forget. One of the things that I believe enabled Sister Peery to create this environment was the way in which she trusted in the Lord's timing, the way that she accepted what the Lord had in store for her. It enabled her to be blessed by the peace of the Spirit. I love Elder Holland. He has such a way with words, and he had this to say about accepting the Lord's timing, waiting on the Lord. He said, COVID and cancer, doubt and dismay, financial trouble and family trials. When will these burdens be lifted? The answer is by and by. And whether that be a short period or a long one, is not always ours to say. But by the grace of God, the blessings will come to those who hold fast to the gospel of Jesus Christ. I love the messages that have been shared, the scriptures that have been selected. I want to add one more and quote the words of our Savior Jesus Christ. Now, this is something that he said unto his friend Martha, as Martha had just undergone the passing of her friend Lazarus. Jesus came, and she went out to meet him. And he saith unto her, Thy brother shall rise again. Martha saith unto him, I know that he shall rise again in the resurrection at the last day. That's an expression of faith on her part. But listen to what the Savior said unto her. He said, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. Believest thou this? I share my witness. That we will never die as we hold fast to the Savior, trust in His timing, and wait on the Lord. His peace will be with us. We'll have no need for our hearts to be troubled. I leave you my witness that Jesus lives, and that because of Him, Karen Peery lives on. And so will each of us, and I share that witness in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Our Father in heaven, as we close this funeral service for Karen Peery, we are grateful for the spirit that we have felt here today. Oh, what a joy it has been to be here. Oh, how lucky we are to have known her. We are thankful for this celebration of her life. Father, as we contemplate the passing and the goodbye that these events are, and as we are faced with the reality of the temporal nature of this life, we are so very thankful for our knowledge that life is eternal. We recognize that this is because of thy Son, Jesus Christ. We are thankful for him, and we are thankful for his gospel. We love him, and Father, we love thee, and we know that thou and he love us as well. Please help us to take this love and to share it with one another. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.
Please rise. Thank you.